Hi folks, hope you're okay today. It's good to be with you. And we're doing our next study. And it's on the grace of God. And we're looking at Ephesians chapter 1. So if you'd like to turn to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. It's good to be with you. Don't forget my website, jasonburnspreacher.com. And you can go on Twitter and Facebook and there's lots of literature, lots of books you can download on the website and other resources that will be a help to you. So let's pray. Father, I just pray, Lord, as we look at your word, I pray, Lord, that this study will be a blessing and a help to people. And Father, I pray that you would use it for your glory. And I pray that it be a blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Ephesians chapter 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints who are at Ephesus and to the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love, having predestined us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of grace, wherein he abounded towards us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he had purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time he had gathered together in one all things, in Christ, both which are to heaven and which are on earth in him, in whom are also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ. In whom also you trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom after that you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. Wherein also I afterwards of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that the eyes of your understanding be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at their own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and given him to be the head of all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. The title of the sermon today is The Grace of God. The grace of God. We see grace demonstrated in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 6 and 7. To the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. Verse 7. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. So God is rich in his grace to us as we come to know him. D.L. Moody says about the grace of God, grace means undeserved kindness. It is the gift of God to man the moment he sees he is unworthy of God's favor. Matthew Henry says of grace, grace is the free, undeserved goodness and favor of God to mankind. And we see the foundation of grace in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 and 9. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherein he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you are saved, and hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. For by grace you are saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Grace is a gift of God. It's something that we didn't deserve, and yet God richly gave it to us. Rosary Butterfield, who was a professor of gay theory in America, was writing articles attacking Christians. She was a lesbian. And one day she started to talk to a Presbyterian minister, and he ministered to her the gospel over many, many months. And slowly but surely she came to know the Lord. She found the grace of God in her life. And I want to talk about three things about grace: electing grace, redemptive grace, and blessed grace. Electing grace, redemptive grace, and a blessed grace. The electing grace of God. There's a joke, a standing joke, of David was dancing before the ark, and his wife said, she wasn't happy he was dancing, and his wife said, it's because he believes in election. And there is a kind of a negativity from many Christians concerning the teaching about election, that God chooses his people. But we have to remember that it is central to Christianity. It is a central doctrine, a central teaching. It's not on the periphery. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. It's right at the heart of the first chapter that God chooses his people. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 4. According he has chosen us in him. When did he choose us? According he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love. God chose you and me before the foundation of the world. Eklogome. He chose us for himself, is the Greek. Spurgeon says, I'm glad he chose me before I was born, before he made me, because if he made me, he would not, and seen me, he would not have chosen me. It's a funny statement. But there are four key words in this choosing that God has. If you go to Ephesians chapter 1 verse 11, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. Look at the words, predestined. Predestinated according, number two, the purpose, who worketh all things according to the counsel for of his own will. What does counsel mean? It means counsel that before the beginning of time, he declared that he would choose you. Will, what does will mean? According to the counsel of his own will, that God's will be achieved in your salvation. Purpose. In whom we also have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all this. There is a purpose. That there is a plan to history. And that predestined is propizo. It means knowing beforehand the horizon and planning beforehand the horizon. In other words, you see, you know what the path is before the horizon. This teaching of election is not something that certain groups of theologians invented. It's something that is at the very heart of Jesus' teaching. If you turn to John 17, verse 6. I have manifest thy name unto them which thou gavest me out of the world. God the Father gave a people to his Son. Verse 9, 17 verse 9. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. So the Father gave a people to the Son. Verse 12. Which thou wast with them in the world. John 17, 12. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept. The Father gave a people to the Son. That's choosing. You see, in the beginning of time, there was a board meeting. And the board meeting was between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And the Father decided that he was going to choose you. The Son decided that he was going to come and die for you. And the Holy Spirit decided that he was going to come and make it a reality. There's a story of a girl in Oxford. She had a boyfriend. She met her husband, at Oxford. And she's Scottish. And she's in Scotland talking to a Scottish minister. And he said, how did you find your husband, the man who was with her? And he was Scottish. She said, well, I was at Oxford University. And he came into the room when we were having some drinks at some kind of welcoming party or something at Oxford University. And when he came in, one of the girls said, look, oh, it's him. He believes in predestination. Again, there's this negativity against this doctrine. It's not a doctrine to be argued. It's a doctrine where we to treat other believers with a gentleness. If other believers don't understand it or don't appreciate it or fully find it difficult, there are difficult questions that come up when this teaching is brought forward, and we've all grappled with them, and so we must be patient with one another in the answering of these questions. They're not easy questions, and they're not easy to answer. And we're not to bash people over the head with it. We're not to cause division with it. But if we would accept it meekly from the Word, it can be a great encouragement to the believer. To know that you were chosen before the beginning of time, that God's love was set upon you before you were even born. Romans 8:30. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. Whom he called, them he also justified. Whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. There's a love that will not let you go. There's a love that will not let you go. What kept Paul in the beatings? What kept Paul in the batterings and the attacks of false teachers and the whippings and the beatings? What kept him going? Because he knew God's love in his life. He knew that God had chosen him and God was keeping him. Before the beginning of time, God knew you and chose you. He not only chose you, but he accomplished your salvation. He came down and he paid the debt. And when he died on that cross, he knew your name specifically. He laid it down for you. and not only laid it down for you, accomplished everything for your salvation, and brought you home by the Holy Spirit. And now he's not going to give up. He's going to keep you. You might feel weak. You might feel you've got a lot of problems. You might feel it's difficult. You might feel it's impossible. You might feel you can't go forward. You might feel the worst Christian ever. You might feel you failed and made a mistake. You might feel a lot of things that seem to be discouraging you. But his love is upon you, and his love will not leave you. His love has chosen you, and his love will keep you. Nothing will separate you from the love of Christ. It's electing love. Now, if you say, well, if he loves me and chosen me, what about the whole world? Does he not love them? Did he not love them in eternity? That's logic. And if you listen to my sermon on Romans 10, and if you listen to Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones on Romans 10, and if you listen to John Calvin on the topic, and if you listen to John Murray on the topic, they will all warn you. And even if you read the Westminster Confession, they will all warn you that there is a mystery involved here. But even though it's a mystery, and I cannot fully understand it, I cannot deny that the Bible teaches that before the foundation of the world, I was loved, you was loved. And to rejoice in that, and to rest in that, and to know that whatever's going on in your life right now, nothing will separate you from the love of God. You're in his grip, my friend. You're in his grip, and your grip might not be on him, and your grip might be weak, and you might even be, your fingernails are just letting go of God. You can't even hold him, but he has got hold of your hand, and he will not let you go. Isn't that a comfort? Isn't that an encouragement? That nothing is going to take you out. Nothing is going to pull you down. Nothing is going to stop you, because God's hand is upon you. Even your own rebellion and sin, God will bring you to repentance and make you see that that is not the way to go. Even in the battering that you might receive from whatever corners in your life, from nasty words spoken to you, from your own mistakes, from opposition, from whatever it is, His love is with you. His love surrounds you. His love is around you. His love is there. No matter how dark your mind might be, no matter how dark it may seem, there is a love around you, a love surrounding you, a love so rich, so beautiful, so wonderful that he's there and he's your daddy. And Paul said, I cry, Abba Father, he's your daddy, and he surrounds you with his love. You're surrounded by the love of God in your life. The electing love of God. 2nd, the redemptive love. The electing grace of God, and now the redemptive grace of God. There was a priest and went to see an elderly lady in Ireland. He went to see this elderly lady. She was lying on her deathbed, and he said, I've come to give you absolution. She's not being well educated, said, excuse me, what do you mean by absolution? Could you explain to me? He said, I've come to forgive you of your sin. She said to him, can I see your hands? He said, why? He was a bit annoyed. Why? I'd like to see your hands. So reluctantly, he showed her his hands. You're an impostor, she said. You can't forgive my sin. Only the man with pierced hands can forgive my sins. Jesus Christ is the only one that can forgive us of our sin. Only he, and his death on that cross, and where he shed his blood and died on that cross and took the wrath and the punishment for my sin, can he forgive my sin, because he paid the debt for me. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, the redemption. What does that mean? He paid your debt. You had nothing to pay your debt with. You owed God, but you could not pay him. It's kind of like a billionaire has a portfolio. They've got millions of pounds invested in this company, millions of pounds invested in that company, and they've got a portfolio of millions and billions of pounds as a billionaire. And then we get your portfolio and you've got about £2. You've got nothing in the bank. You're skint, you're poor. That's your portfolio. And then one day somebody just puts into your account a massive billions of pounds, and now your portfolio is bursting. You had nothing in your spiritual portfolio. Your portfolio was empty, but God filled it with redemption. He paid your debt. He paid your price. He filled your cup to overflowing with the grace of God. Isaiah 43:25. Oh, is your sin as black as black? Is your sin as dark as dark? Come with me to Isaiah 43:25. Thou hast not brought me the small cattle. Yep, where's it? Isaiah 43:25. I am he that blotteth out thy transgression for my own sake, and will not remember thy sins. He blots out your sin. Isaiah 44:22. I have blotted out as a thick cloud thy transgressions, and as a cloud thy sins. Return unto me, for I have redeemed thee. Every sin that you have committed, he blots out. He blots out the dark, dark stain in our lives. He blots out with his blood. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I love that old hymn, oh, the deep, deep blood of Jesus, vast, unmeasured, boundless, free, rolling as a mighty ocean in its fullness over me. The mighty blood of Christ, that he would lay down his life and shed his blood, divine blood, for me, that he would lay down his life for me. What love is this? We was in town in the south side of Manchester, me and a friend of mine, and we were talking to this lady. She was a drunk lady, and my friend took her to side and was talking to her, and she said she couldn't be forgiven, that she had sinned so much that she could never be forgiven. Let me take you to Romans chapter 8. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, there is no condemnation. However dark, however deep the stain of sin may be in your life, you may stink of it to the very core of your being. And you may feel that you can never be forgiven. But when Christ died on that cross and shed his blood on that cross, he was dying on that cross for all your mistakes and all my mistakes, with all the sin and all the filth and all the mistakes and all the wickedness of our own hearts. He laid down his life that we may live. He laid down his life that you may live. Never say that you can never be forgiven. Never say, as a non-believer, Jay, he doesn't want me, he cannot forgive me, he doesn't want me, my friend. He says, those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He wants you, come, freely drink of the grace of God, freely come and plunge under the blood of grace of God and say, Lord, forgive me, and plunge into the grace of God, plunge into the joy of his love, the joy of his grace, and enjoy the riches of his grace. Come. You say, Jay, I don't believe, I've never believed, I can never be accepted. I've been a prostitute, I've been a murderer, I've been a foul blasphemer, I've slept around, I've fought, I've been bitter, I've been angry, I've stolen, I'm just a materialist. Jay, I've been in witchcraft, I've been in tarot cards. Oh, Jay, you don't know what I've done. Jay, I've made big mistakes. Come to the Messiah, come to the Master. Come to him, and when you come to him, he is gentle and he is kind and he is loving, and he will put your arms around you. He will put his arms around you and he will forgive you. Come. And for the believer who has struggled and failed and made mistakes, maybe you've made a big mistake, maybe you keep making mistakes, whatever, come. Come, you say, no, I blew it this time. He will blot out your transgressions if you come. He will not turn away a broken and contrite heart. He will not turn away a man or a woman who is broken because of their sin. Come. There is now no condemnation to them that are in Christ. Stop looking at your sin and start looking at the cross. Stop looking at yourself and start looking at Jesus and trusting in him as your Savior. Come. And then we've looked at the electing love of God, the electing grace of God, the redemptive grace of God, and then finally, the blessings of the grace of God. We as English, whenever it's a sunny day, we can even be talking about the weather and how bad it is. And sometimes we can be negative. And we need to be positive. We need to be positive. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. Ephesians 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. He's blessed. He's saying, look, we're richly blessed. We have all the riches of his grace in our lives. We need to be thinking about the blessings we have in Christ. Not about the things that we don't have, but about the things that we have in Christ. And it's all in Christ. All our blessings are in Christ. Verse 2. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and what? From the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Christ. Verse 4. According he has chosen us in who? In him. Christ. Before the beginning. Before the foundation of the world. Verse 6. To the praise of the glory of the grace wherein he hath made us accepted in whom? In the beloved. Who's that? Christ. Verse 7. In whom we have redemption through his blood. Whose blood? Jesus' blood. Christ. And it goes on and on and on. The riches of the grace of God come through Christ. We're adopted in Christ. Verse 5. Having predestined us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ. We're adopted into his family. And we have the presence of his acceptance. We have, the presence of his Holy Spirit. Verse 13. In whom also we trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, whom also you that you believe you were what? Sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. How blessed we are. We have the Holy Spirit. We have a down payment of heaven right now. We have a taste of heaven right now. We have a taste of glory right now. We have a taste of it right now in the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. We're blessed. It's all in Christ. We're adopted. We have the Holy Spirit. We are accepted, verse 6, accepted in the Beloved. There is no wall between me and God, between you and God now in Christ. Isn't that wonderful? So let us rejoice in the Lord. Let us rejoice in his blessings. Let us rejoice and praise God. Bring praise to him. Notice verse 6. To the praise of the glory of his grace wherein he had made us accepted in the Beloved. Praise. If our theology does not lead to praise, there's something wrong with our theology. If it's just head knowledge, but not working out in the heart where we're praising God, there's something wrong. We have to be praising God if our theology's right. So, what is the application of the grace of God in our lives? We've come to the end. We've looked at the electing grace of God, the redemptive grace of God, and the blessings of the grace of God. But what's the application? How do we apply this to our lives? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. It should lead to a humble life. Knowing the grace of God should lead to a humble lifestyle. Ephesians 4, verse 1. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherein you call, verse 2, with all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love. If your theology doesn't bring love in your life, there's something wrong with your theology. Your theology should lead to a loving lifestyle, a humble lifestyle. If you're prickly and always causing issues with people because you're prickly, your theology is not right. You need to understand the grace of God more clearly, spiritually, because it should bring a humility and a love in your life. And it should spring out into relationships. Ephesians 5:22. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Saviour of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. So, it should work out in relationships. Children should be more submissive to their parents. Wives should be more submissive to their husbands. Husbands should be more loving to their wives. It should work out in our family life. Are we working the grace of God that is at work in our lives? Is it at work in others, in our family? Thirdly, the grace of God means that we're on the front line. God has not just saved us and that's it. We're saved for a purpose. To display his glory. And part of displaying his glory is to know that he's put us on the front line. There's going to be a battle in this knowing the grace of God. Ephesians 6, verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. There's going to be a battle on. That battle is going to be fierce. That battle is a spiritual battle where the demonic forces are going to come and try and take you out, but God has put you on the front line to demonstrate His glory of grace. So you've got to put on the spiritual armor. And you need to read Ephesians 6 and the last verses in Ephesians 6 about putting on the whole armor of God. So you're going to be under attack if you know the Lord. You're going to be under spiritual attack, and you need to be prepared to resist that attack if you know the grace of God. And then finally, praise. If you know the grace of God, it should bring praise. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 18. May be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, length, and depth, and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Verse 21, unto Him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. It's leading to praise, praising Christ, praising Him, adoring Him, worshipping Him. J.I. Packer says about this grace of God, I am on the palm of His hands. I am near His own mind. I am near His mind. I am graven on the palm of His hands. That is the grace of God in your life. You are engraven on the palm of His hands today. I want to tell you a story. There was a man who was captured in the Spanish Inquisition, and even today you can see a skeleton, and this skeleton is in a castle in Spain, and the skeleton is hands chained. Obviously this man died for his faith, but as this man was dying, where the skeleton was, with his hand in the chains, right next to the hand was something etched into the wall, and it was a cross. But this man also etched these words, verse 18 of Ephesians 3, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, length, and depth, and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. But right where that skeleton is, with his hand in the chains, and right there he etched a cross, and he etched those words, and to know the love of Christ, which passeth all knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. And that is my message to you today, that you might be like that guy. You might feel that your mind is in a prison. You might feel that there's no way out, there is no future, there is no purpose, and things might seem very, very dark for you. But the grace of God chose you before the beginning of time. The grace of God paid your debt on the cross, and the grace of God has brought you home so that you can praise and worship Him. And God's love is with you right now. And that love will keep you. It is amazing grace that has been shown you. So no matter how dark it might feel at this moment in time, or no matter how difficult it may feel, my message to you is what J.I. Packer said. My message to you is, J.I. Packer said, a theologian, he said, I am graven on the palm of His hands. And you're graven on the palm of God's hands. He has filled you with His riches of His grace. You are truly blessed. And you're okay. God is with you. So don't get discouraged. Don't get down. And if you don't know the Lord today as your Saviour, if you confess your sin, and trust Him as your Lord, you will find that amazing grace in your life. I hope this has been a blessing to you, and I pray that it would encourage you in your walk and in your service for the Lord. Let's pray. Father, you have shown us great truths today, truths that we can't even begin to understand fully. But Father, I pray that all the people that hear this message today, that it might fill them with your love, fill them with your grace, fill them with your power. Father, I pray that they would just be touched by your love today, that they might know that they're not on their own, that you have saved them by your grace, and that they can rest in your love today and know that all is well. Bless them, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. I hope that was a blessing to you. And keep going in the Lord. Don't get discouraged. Don't get down. If you need to talk, contact me. If you haven't got anywhere for Christmas, let me know. You can come here. If you need encouragement, let me know and I'll encourage you. So God bless you. Keep going and don't give up. Take care now. God bless.